This presentation will help you to get the most out of your learning experience. In this session, you will understand when not to study, compare and contrast different learning styles, identify your preferred learning style, and discover ways to improve your memory retention and recall. Let's first run through some reasons for not getting the books or the horses out for a study session. When you're fatigued, this is about brain space, and you really do need to make sure that you have some so that the information you are gathering gets into your brain so that it exists for recall later. You could, however, find a means of studying that requires less intensive effort, such as making recordings of your notes or listening to them back. So don't feel pressured to study in the usual way when you are fatigued. Find a study activity that is less intensive that you can do for a shorter time. When you're stressed, get the recordings out again or colour in some diagrams for distractions that can help de-stress you. Don't sit down to do some heavy duty learning. Modify the learning activity to something you feel capable of doing, depending on your state of mind at the time. When you're hungry or too soon after a meal, feeling hungry can be very distracting, and trying to study too soon after a meal when blood circulation is diverted from peripheral regions, including the brain, to the stomach to begin the digestive process will not be effective, unless again you're viewing, listening or colouring in and the required brain power is not intensive. When you have time constraints, intensive study requires a significant amount of time, although if you switch to using study techniques such as information presented on flashcards, you can always fit some study time in throughout the day at intervals, or whenever you are around a horse, a saddle, or a rider, make sure to always run through something for a few minutes. You may need to get very creative with the techniques you use if you always feel pressured about time. Similarly, when you've got other urgent tasks to do, and that can make you rather twitchy and inclined to rush or lack focus, do a couple of the urgent tasks first, then settle down to study. It can help to take a lot of pressure off. When you're feeling anxious, again, it's distracting and you won't be able to relax and get into the flow of studying. When you're lacking focus, and there are days when focus comes to you easily and other days when you just can't seem to get focused at all. Being aware of this just helps to take the pressure off and realise that sometimes your brain can be fatigued without you even knowing it. Focusing is a skill which requires practice to switch in and out of, and you can learn to do this with creative study plans. At the wrong time of day for you, and this is a big one, so I will keep referring back to it throughout this series of film, because there is a clear difference between night owl learners and morning lark learners. I know that I'm a lark and not a night owl, and I know that if I have an important piece of thinking to do, I have much more clarity of thought between 4 a.m. and 9 a.m. I'm just so much faster then. I'm refreshed from having had some sleep, and my thinking is particularly fluent at that time. Sometimes problem solving in seconds after pondering on them for some considerable time the previous day. I can get an enormous amount of quality work done before 9 a.m. Do recognise what times of day your brain is at its most effective. Distractions. It's important, as far as you can, to remove any of them before you start your focus study session. Although I will point out that you should be able to engage in studying, even in small increments throughout the day, just to keep reminding yourself of the information. Both strategies work well, especially if combined. If every little can help for a large superstore, then it can help for students, and they would have paid a lot of money for that motto, so take heed. Surrounded by clutter. Clutter is psychologically toxic. You won't even know the true effect it's having on you, particularly if you find yourself wishing that it wasn't there. A well-organized, or ideally a clear, desk which reflects your feelings of having space to learn is essential preparation for focused study. If you're cluttered, your information gathering and retention will also be cluttered. Take a power minute to clear and organize a space before you start to study. Move empty coffee mugs. Clear paper to the recycling bin. Stack files or books neatly so that you have them to hand. And you never know, if you study often enough and regularly clear space, the clutter might one day have magicked itself away. Don't study without the necessary equipment, and that's true for many equestrian tasks, since we always need to have so much of it. Before you sit down to study, make sure you have all the resources you need to do it. When you have everything together, your memory sticks, highlighter pens, books, pens, you will feel like your studying flows much better. When you're lacking motivation, there can be whole days when your reason for being completely eludes you, when you're feeling rather lost or off with the fairies. Just accept it. Perhaps this is our brain's way of urging us to engage in psychological self-care so that we can get back to our factory settings a little sooner. When you lack motivation at the beginning of each study session, take a moment to get everything into perspective and remind yourself of your personal goals and why you are studying. Looking at the big picture can pull you back to your true purpose and win you your mojo back. Know your learning style. There are three separate learning modalities, although they can often be combined, but most of us have a strong preference for how we have important information presented to us. The first is visual. The information is in picture form or demonstrated, or diagrams. The second is auditory, and this means that you like to have your information spoken to you or presented to you in text or discussed with you. The third is kinesthetic, which means that you are very much hands-on, perhaps putting stickers on a horse to illustrate the origins and insertions of muscles is more effective for you than reading them as words in a textbook. The first example is a PowerPoint slide containing text with the presenter talking you through it. And without having a picture to illustrate this topic, this is purely auditory. It's a very common style, but unfortunately, if there are too many words on the screen or no discussion or anecdotes to support it, and the presenter just reads off the screen, the meaning can be lost to visual and kinesthetic learners. Students will sit and read the screen instead of paying attention to the presenter as soon as the words appear on a screen. A technique I use is to only reveal one point at a time because it helps to guide separate thoughts. The second example is kinesthetic, where the student is invited to feel what the presenter is explaining. The third example is a presentation, and it's very visual. It helps to contextualize information so that words on paper can come to life. In a group setting, although there can be discussion, which is auditory, there is unlikely to be any kinesthetic opportunities for learning here unless students are sent off for practice. When they are sent off for practice in small groups, all learning styles will be catered for and richly blended learning can take place. I often encounter students in small groups where one student will be discussing, another will be referring back to their notes, another has their hands on and watching for signals from the horse. It's all high quality learning experience to each individual learner. The fourth example is kinesthetic and a good example of dual coding, where I'm demonstrating how to locate seat bones, which is less embarrassing than poking around downstairs on the rider, of course. In this example, the rider can truly get the meaning of the concept as their body is moved around and at the same time receiving an explanation. The demonstrator can step back and position their body to give the learner a visual. A small whiteboard for drawing a diagram could be close to hand, or even a model pelvis that the rider can handle for clarity of what their seat bones actually look like. And this doesn't mean that if your preference is for visual learning, you're only visual, or if you prefer listening, that you can't learn visually. No, it's just your predominating style and the one that you feel most confident and comfortable with in terms of acquiring detail of information. Recognize that there is typically a mix of styles or combinations at play. And this is known as dual coding and is a highly effective learning experience. For optimized learning, determine your preferred learning style. Although for experiential vocational study, it's unlikely that you will get all the learning experience you need from a textbook or watching a screen. Getting your hands on is critical. Your clients will not want you to only talk to them when you visit, unless, of course, they too are an auditory learner. Combine methods. This works well for knowledge assimilation. Aim to apply dual coding of styles, where a variety is applied simultaneously, because this is highly effective for information assimilation, retention, and later recall. And think about how children learn when playing independently. They will gravitate towards the most creative illustrations, storytelling, role-playing, questioning, and touching when given something new to explore without the constraints of self-consciousness. And the more creative or childlike you can get with your learning, the more efficient and proficient you can become with it. So in this image of a teaching session on the right, the learners are getting a visual of the vertebrae as they would appear within the body. There is an auditory explanation from the presenter. And the anatomical arrangement can be discussed. We could make chalk marks on the horse's back beneath it, and the students can palpate the structures kinesthetically with the specimen to hand. An anatomy book is available, together with a whiteboard for further clarification if needed. I even have steps to encourage students to move into different positions for even greater clarity, and so that they have as many information opportunities as possible that suit their individual learning styles. In the next presentation, we will explore memory retention and recall.